Welcome, everybody. Welcome to our roundtable on the dollar in American foreign policy, a look back and ahead. Our speaker today is Professor Jeffrey Garten. Jeff is the author of this fascinating new book, which I highly commend to you, hot off the presses. It's called 3 Days at Camp David, How a Secret Meeting in 1971 Transformed the Global Economy. Welcome, Jeff.
Thank you very much.
Jeff, I'd like to dive right in on this fascinating new book of yours. Can you lay out for us the situation in August 1971 when President Nixon assembled his top economic and some of his top political advisors at Camp David? What was going on?
Well, I have to start actually with the Bretton Woods Agreement of 1944, which created a system in which the dollar was really the center of the global economy. And the dollar was linked to gold at a fixed rate, $35 to an ounce. And every other currency, every other major currency was linked at a fixed rate to the dollar. And this system was designed to create stability for the post-war international commercial scene. And it was a system that worked extraordinarily well. It really was at the heart of the recovery of Western Europe and Japan from the war, a phenomenal recovery by any means. And it was also very advantageous to the US, which had extraordinarily good economic conditions throughout the 50s and the 60s. So Nixon arrives in 1969, and he is beset by a whole slew of problems. And these problems are impinging on the dollar because other countries are beginning to worry that this gold dollar standard cannot hold, that rate, that fixed rate, which basically made it so the United States guaranteed all foreign governments and central banks that if they didn't want their dollars, they could exchange it for gold.
So what was our monetary gold supply at the time? And what were our liabilities?
Right, in the mid 50s, we had 160% coverage of gold to dollars. So the exchange was no problem. But by 1971, we only had 10% of the gold that we needed. And so it was a fiction. It became a fiction that the United States could actually convert dollars for gold.
So how are we holding the system together up until August 1971?
Well, in part, it was held together because there was such economic growth. I mean, everybody was benefiting. And so it was to no one's advantage to say the emperor had no clothes. Also, it was held together because if anybody said that, there was a fear that the global economy would just go into a tailspin. So it's held up by that fiction. Also, the US over the years, seeing this gold drain or trying to stop it, imposed a lot of capital controls, which incidentally was permitted under the IMF rules at the time. And what really brought this to a head was not just that the US didn't have enough gold, but that inflation began to erode the purchasing power of dollars. And the inflation started with President Johnson in the late 60s and his failure to impose taxes to finance the Vietnam War. But it began to accelerate in Nixon's first couple of years, so that foreign governments were becoming really worried. They knew there wasn't enough gold. The dollars they had were eroding because of inflation. And they were looking at the US and demanding that we take some domestic measures in order to make the dollar more credible. Measures that would hold down inflation, principally that, but measures that also would cut the growing budget deficits that were also worrying a lot of other countries. And in 1971, all of this came to a head, including the fact that we ran our first trade deficit since the late 19th century.
So what's special about August 1971? If we had just decided to ignore the problem for another year or so, what would have happened?
Well, there was a real concern. You know, the dollars started to leave the U.S. And Germany was in a really, the German economy, the Deutsche Mark was really undervalued. So money started to flow into Germany, also into the Netherlands. And the money was trying to flow into Japan, although they were very skillful in controlling it. And there was just a fear that we were going to have a major financial crisis, and the U.S. had to grab hold of it. I mean, I guess it's still the case today. But then, everyone was looking at Washington to get a grip. And so, what really frightened Nixon and the people around him was that they were afraid that some government was going to come in and demand gold, and the whole system would cave. And in August, money started to flow out again. This had been a recurrent problem, but it really started to flow into West Germany. Germany floated the Deutsche Mark, and Nixon felt the game was up because it looked like any further disturbance would basically create a major global financial crisis.
So who are the main protagonists there at Camp David that President Nixon assembled? And what were their different positions? In other words, what were the hard options that were on the table? And who is backing what?
You know, Nixon assembled, in retrospect, an extraordinary team, a few of whom were known, most of whom weren't. The key to the team was John Connally, who had been the governor of Texas for three terms. And Connally was an unbridled nationalist. He stood out from virtually all the others in the administration. He would have been very much at home in a Trump administration. You know, his motto really was, we have to screw the foreigners before they screw us. And Nixon put him in charge of this whole effort.
So not an academic economist, neither.
Not an economist at all. And even he would have said, and everybody around him would have said, he didn't really care much about economics. He was a politician, but very, very smart, exceedingly smart, and very quick to learn. His right-hand man was a fellow that nobody had heard of named Paul Volcker. Volcker was a technocrat and worked very closely with Connally. Connally basically had no position other than how do we get foreign countries to do more for us. He really focused on the closed markets for American exports, and he thought a devalued dollar was the key to expanding American jobs.
Not everyone around the table agreed with him.
No. In fact, I don't think anyone was even close to holding that position passionately. And Connally was really mostly interested in Nixon's political fortunes. Remember, this was Nixon in 71. It was a couple of years before Watergate, and he was considered to be a very, very effective president at that time. So there was Paul Volcker. There was Arthur Burns, who had just become the chairman of the Federal Reserve. And basically he knew there had to be a change, but you know, being a central banker, he wanted this to be done very smoothly and even through a multilateral negotiation.
And Burns, interestingly enough, in a contemporary context, didn't actually believe that inflation could be effectively controlled through monetary policy, did he?
That's right. And one of the decisions that was made during this three-day meeting at Camp David was to impose a wage and price freeze for 90 days on everything. I mean, unprecedented in peacetime. And that eventually turned into years of wage and price controls, which, of course, was a total disaster. Then there was a young guy named George Shultz.
Schultz's position at the time?
Shultz was a disciple of Milton Friedman.
What was his position in the government at the time?
He started out as Secretary of Labor and very quickly became the Director of the Office of Management and Budget. Very highly thought of by Nixon as the only economist who could actually get something done. But Shultz had a very strong view that the entire monetary system was outdated and that we should move to floating exchange rates.
How radical was that position at the time?
It was pretty radical. I would say it was not as radical as it might have been 10 years before. And Milton Friedman had been writing about it. Others had been writing about it. I think there was some support in the private sector, but it was a minority view, and I think it was also seen as being exceedingly risky. And then there was a young guy from industry named Pete Peterson, who was actually not fixed so much on exchange rates or on trade openings, but on the need for the U.S. to dramatically expand its investment in technology and in the skills of the workforce. He was the one who was saying you can't solve American problems just with macroeconomic policy. And those were the key people. There was Paul McCracken, who was head of the Council of Economic Advisors, very highly thought of. And he backed Shultz in terms of floating exchange rates until the end, and then felt it's too risky. So those are the basics.
So what about the foreign policy people who are in the background, people like Henry Kissinger? You describe it very nicely in the book. Henry Kissinger is extremely, he's not an economist. He's extremely concerned about what's being discussed at Camp David, right? What is he specifically concerned about? Why is he concerned, and what does he want done or not done?
Well, at that meeting that I write about and in detail, Kissinger wasn't there.
Right.
Well, let's put it this way. Rogers, who was the Secretary of State, wasn't there because Nixon really didn't have any confidence in him. Kissinger was the National Security Advisor, and he was in Paris negotiating with the North Vietnamese. And with Connally running the meeting, Connally couldn't have cared less about foreign policy. But as soon as the meeting was over, Kissinger was briefed, and he was apoplectic about how the Allies had been treated, because the decision that was made that weekend to de-link the dollar from gold and to force other countries to set new values for their currencies such that the dollar would be effectively devalued, it really was to force Western Germany and Japan to revalue significantly. Kissinger felt that the administration had run roughshod over allies that we needed. It was obviously the middle of the Cold War, but we needed them immediately for two other reasons, which was Nixon was about to go to China, and at all costs, he didn't want the Allies in disarray. And he was then going to go to Russia for really the beginning of arms control negotiations, and he needed the Allies for that too.
And Kissinger understands that Connally is a major player, right? As you describe it in the book, Kissinger is actually very flattering towards Connally. He knows that he can't bull over Connally himself. He's got to make some sort of an alliance with Connally. Is that fair?
I think it's fair to say that Kissinger, that Connally was very close to Nixon. Mm-hmm. Nixon had a lot of confidence in Connally, and Kissinger understood that situation. And so he exercised his own personal diplomacy to work with Connally in order to smooth the feathers of the Allies. And I describe in the book what happened after this meeting, which was a series of negotiations in which Kissinger had a lot of influence. And it was Kissinger who persuaded Nixon to bring the negotiations to a halt far sooner than Connally would have wanted, because Kissinger felt that we were creating a backlash of a very significant magnitude. Because you have to remember this. For the United States, this was a big deal, but international transactions as a percentage of our economy was still quite small. For Western Germany and Japan, the rest of Western Europe, the dollar in trade was a very large part of everything of their whole being. And Kissinger understood this. Connally couldn't have cared less about it. And one of the interesting things about the whole saga was how Nixon kind of orchestrated the Kissinger-Connally relationship. And in the end, the foreign policy considerations were really brought to bear. And 2 months after this, three months after the Camp David meeting, a new monetary system was agreed on.
Okay, so walk us through what were the major decisions that were made at Camp David, first of all. Can you walk us through them one by one?
Yeah. Well, a huge decision was, in order to deal with inflation, as you said, Arthur Burns simply didn't believe that inflation could be tamed with fiscal and monetary policy. And he had been advocating wage and price controls of one kind or another. And they made a decision at Camp David for a 3-month freeze on all wages and prices in the US economy. I mean, it's almost mind-boggling that they would do something like this. And George Shultz, the free marketer, was apoplectic about it, but he was given the job of actually managing it. So that was one big thing. Second is that there were a series of tax incentives to get the economy growing faster. And what's interesting about many of these incentives were Buy America incentives. For example, there was an incentive that came with buying automobiles, but only automobiles that were made in the US. So there was a very nationalist tinge to this. And that was, added to that was a 10% across the board tariff on all imports, which drove the Allies crazy. Even more than the monetary, even more than delinking the dollar from gold, which was the next decision, they were so dependent on the US market for trade that the notion that we would put this 10% across the board tariff on horrified them, because they thought this was the beginning of an American philosophical turn towards protectionism. And they didn't just pull this out of the air, they were watching the Congress, which was another reason why Nixon was so upset. The Congress was beginning to propose the most protectionist legislation that we had seen since the 1930s.
Let me just interrupt you very, very briefly on this. One thing that comes out nicely in your account is this tension in the room between this sort of America First vision of where we should be going and how we should be handling our problems, and this view that maintaining the international order is all important, and we must do nothing to threaten that. How are these tensions managed?
I think that's a really important point. You have, on the one hand, a very strong movement in the US, I think in large part a reaction to the Vietnam War, and also a reaction to the mounting domestic problems, the racial tensions, the problems in the cities. You know, there were unemployment was growing. And so there was a kind of what was called at the time new isolationism. And a lot of the measures that were taken at Camp David could easily fit into that mold. But most of the people around the table, all but Connolly, they thought we had to do something, not because we were trying to cater to the nationalists, but precisely to save the global economic order, which was quite open and in the process of opening more. And they thought that these sort of tough love measures were the only way to do it, only way to quell domestic unrest. So at the same time that we were pressing the Allies on monetary policy, we were demanding that part of this agreement was demanding that they open their markets to American exports. We wanted them to grow faster, but nobody except Connolly was at all relaxed about the overall situation, because they didn't want to tip it over into a more constricted global economy. And one of the great successes, I think, was that following the August meeting, in fact, if you look at the next couple of years, it was really the beginning of the opening of the world economy. It was really the beginning of the flourishing of globalization. And so they did preserve, they not only preserved the order, they strengthened it.
What were the decisions that were made that were specifically related to exchange rate management, the international monetary system as such?
Well, one was that the U.S. would close the so-called gold window. That is, the promise of convertibility was no more. They left open the possibility that there would be convertibility into the future. And they kept talking about that possibility, but my reading is no one really thought it could happen, because we just didn't have enough gold. There was some hope that maybe special drawing rights, the IMF currency, could join gold, but for the time being, no conversion into gold. Secondly, they wanted Japan and West Germany in particular to make massive revaluations. They didn't want technically to devalue the dollar. They thought that would be a political humiliation, and devaluing the dollar against gold would have required congressional action, and they had no idea where that would end up. And they felt aggrieved. They thought that the surplus countries, the so-called surplus countries, had an obligation to make an adjustment. So they pressed, one of the decisions was to a full court press on allies to revalue.
And how did that work out?
It worked out. I mean, it was kind of acrimonious, because these countries, they didn't want to revalue. Germany was willing to revalue some, but you know, Germany and Japan were very dependent on exports, and a revaluation created enormous problems for them. But in the end, they did. In the end, the U.S. agreed to devalue, and these countries agreed to revalue. And then nobody was talking about floating rates. They wanted to fix the rates again, sort of realign the rates with new currency relationships. And that's what happened at the end of the year. Between the August meeting and Christmas, this massive negotiation took place, It moved from London to Paris to Rome to the Azores to back to Washington. It was really quite a rolling show. But in the end, and in the end, it was Connally who really knocked heads together. But Kissinger sort of on the side saying, you've got to finish it. Because Connally would have tried to use US leverage for months and months to come. And Kissinger was really afraid that that could really drive a wedge in the alliance.
Okay. I've got a few more questions for you, but I want to remind everybody, because I'm going to open things up for questions shortly. If you'd like to ask a question, please click on the raised hand icon on the bottom of your screen, and I'll get to everybody in order. So, Jeff, the world of monetary affairs was not sorted out over these 3 days in August. Can you just briefly walk us through what happened over the next few years that got us basically into the system we're in now, or non-system, as it were, of floating exchange rates?
Well, after the August meeting, the August meeting basically was a unilateral set of US decisions. And the United States had no way to force other countries to revalue. Let me put it this way, that the United States was not about to use the full force of its foreign policy to try to do that. That was a bridge too far for Nixon. And so there was a negotiation. And by December, they had negotiated new exchange rate parities. But within 18 months, the parities didn't hold. And one reason they didn't hold is that the United States was not willing to take the domestic measures, such as raising interest rates, really cutting back on fiscal deficits, maybe taking advantage of more investments in technology. They simply, once the August agreement was made, once the December agreement was made, Nixon got interested in other stuff. Connally left the government. And so the values that were set at the so-called Smithsonian Agreement, which is the one that was December of 1971, they simply couldn't hold. There had to be, the US felt that its currency was still overvalued. It wasn't seeing the value and wasn't seeing the trade deficit decrease. And so the US basically pressed for another agreement, and the next agreement didn't hold. And then the oil price, then came OPEC. And the whole world economy was really in turmoil. And so all the fixed exchange rates, or most of them, really broke apart. And we entered an era of floating exchange rates without ever having determined that that should be the system. And that went on for a couple of years. And by 1976, in the so-called Jamaica Accords, the IMF finally blessed the system, or as you say, the non-system of floating exchange rates.
So there was never really an affirmative decision to move into a new world monetary order, was there?
I don't think so. I mean, I don't want to get into semantics, but I think there was a recognition that this is where it was headed. And when what happened was that Connally resigned after the first agreement. Schultz came along, and he was trying to fashion something between fixed rates and floating rates with a lot of rules, and that didn't hold. And then the Secretary of the Treasury was someone named William Simon, who was a real ideologue. And he basically declared, anybody who wants to float can float. And a year or two after that, maybe a year after that, the IMF said, this is our system. So you're right, we drifted into it. But I think a more positive way to say it is, it could not have been done any other way. The August meeting that I write about was really the end of an era. We had to make a transition to something else, and you couldn't make that transition in one jump. So we ended up with this system, and it has, you know, it was good for the United States, I think. It allowed us to champion globalization because we had some, our domestic policies were a little more insulated. We had more flexibility, and the dollar, after all, stayed as the central currency to the world economy. We didn't lose
this
any.
This is interesting, isn't it? You and I have talked about Bretton Woods before, which of course is a subject near and dear to my heart. Right. Harry Dexter White, who was the Treasury official, who was mostly responsible for the architecture of the IMF and the dollar-based international monetary system, had written in his own private papers that it was inconceivable that the United States could ever cut its link to gold or would ever be forced to cut its link to gold. But if that should ever happen for whatever insane reason, it was intuitively obvious that the dollar would cease to have any significant international role anymore. And he was clearly empirically very wrong about that, wasn't he?
Yeah, but you know,
what do you think he missed? Why does it work to the extent that it works?
Well, I think there's a couple of factors. First of all, you know, I don't want to use the jargon, but there's kind of network effects that everybody has been using the dollar. At that time, everybody had been using the dollar. It was very easy to stay, you know, there were a lot of centrifugal forces there. I think the other thing is that once the dollar was not backed by anything tangible, other factors, everything became relative, and other factors such as the size of the US economy, the dynamism of the US economy, the international confidence in our institutions, Federal Reserve, the SEC, we had a great advantage. No one had such institutions that enjoyed, you know, so much respect. The rule of law. And then something which is, I mean, to me personally, kind of sad, is that I think there was a more tangible view about the durability of our democratic system and how decisions would be made and the openness with which they would be made. And, you know, personally, I'm really worried about that. I'm worried about the whole issue of American institutions and the strength that they will have and how other governments and other societies will look at us. And I think this is, you know, this is really, maybe it's not so much an economic point, but it may be the biggest issue of all. Because the confidence in the dollar is based on a lot of things, a lot of intangibles. So I think that's, you know, that's why the dollar stayed central. And also there was no rival that
obvious
arose.
Obvious alternative, was there?
Right.
Okay, Julissa, I wanna open things up for questions. So do you want to walk our participants through the instructions for asking questions one more time?
Sure, absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder to ask a question during the Q&A period, click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you're called on to speak, please accept the unmute now button, then proceed with your name, affiliation, followed by your question. Your video will remain off, but your microphone will be unmuted. Back over to you, Ben.
Okay, we've got a question from Ted Truman. Ted, you want to unmute yourself?
I did. Thank you. Ted Truman, actually, I'm currently at the Masavar Gomani Center for Business and Government at Kennedy School of Harvard. I noticed CFR has, I haven't updated my profile. This is a great book. I contributed marginally. And it is correct that it is a watershed event which has been underappreciated in I think the literature. One can ask, as you did, I think, Ben, about the timing. You can say it was inevitable, which I think we would all agree, or most of us would agree. I think probably a little more than you brought out in your conversation, it was about domestic politics and the election, and they didn't want to have a crisis between August of 71 and November of 72. So let's get it over with, plus the domestic measures. And some people focused only on the domestic measures. I know Dick Cooper, for example, said this is all about the domestic measures. I talked to him at the time. I do think it's important to remember that Connally was Nixon's second Secretary of the Treasury. So there was an evolution from Kennedy to Connally. Volcker was a holdover. And Schultz, I think, was, notwithstanding his reputation by the end of his life, right? But at the time, he was a labor economist. So he actually didn't know much in the way of macroeconomics. I mean, he became pretty educated about that. Although he may have been influenced by Friedman and so forth and so on, it wasn't as if he had strong views on that stuff. At least that was my impression when I watched him in my initial days at the Fed. I think the last thing which you didn't emphasize at least your remarks, Jeff, is that the system, including the official system, had worried about this for a decade. I mean, in some sense, they started worrying about it in the Kennedy administration, right? They had various groups, blah, blah, blah. That ended up with the SDR sort of was at the end of the 1960s. But it wasn't as if this whole thing, including the exchange rate regime, wasn't debated, hadn't been debated even in official circles, right? In a certain secondhand way. And then that's one of the senses in which it was inevitable, because it had been, as if no one, it wasn't a surprise in that sense. But it's a really gripping story, and you're right that it's a watershed event. So, thank you.
Let me just thanks, Ted. And Ted was really, really helpful to me, very modest in how he put it. The thing is that the seeds of the destruction of the fixed of the dollar gold standard were seen even in the late 50s. There was an economist named Robert Triffin who said that, you know, as long as the dollar was tied to gold and as long as the dollar was the one global currency, something had to give, because there would be a need for more and more dollars to finance the recovery and the growth of the global economy. And at some point, there's going to be too many dollars relative to U.S. gold. So he foresaw that. And I think one interesting thing here, which is kind of relevant to the future too, is we know about crises, or we talk about them, we study them, we anticipate them. But it's in the human nature to wait till the very last minute to do anything about it. And in this case, it was really late in the game. I think Ted is right. I know Ted is right that it wasn't like people didn't think about this, but they were really afraid to act, because everybody knew that the dollar gold standard was at the heart of a thriving global economy that no one could have envisioned at the end of the Second World War. And to change that was something that was really frightening.
You know what I find fascinating, Jeff, that, you know, despite the fact that, as you emphasized, the post-war recovery was pretty remarkable, the Bretton Woods monetary system was almost continually under attack from both the left and the right. You mentioned Triffin, for example. He supported moving towards Keynes's idea of a supranational currency, Bancor. And of course, the SDR was a downgraded, bastardized version of Bangor, which was everything to everybody because it meant, you know, effectively doing nothing. But on the right, you had economists like Jacques Rueff, who was President de Gaulle's primary economic advisor, who agreed with Triffin, this system is absolutely unsustainable, it has to break up, but wanted to go in a totally different direction. He wanted to go back to a classical gold standard where monetary policy would be, if not dictated by, significantly driven by flows of gold across borders. And of course, I think you'd agree neither of those solutions was politically possible at the time. So floating exchange rates was sort of the least common denominator. That's the, you know, the only thing that if not everybody could agree on, nobody could stop, as it were, if everybody decided to get out of the existing system. Is that fair?
I think that's fair. I think, you know, one of the elements here is capital flows. Correct me if I'm wrong, Ben, because you're the expert. You're by far the expert here. But at Bretton Woods, there was no contemplation that private capital flows would play a major role. As I said before, capital controls were allowed in the system.
Oh, very, very, and indeed encouraged. John Maynard Keynes, who was head of the British delegation, Harry Dexter White, who wasn't head of the American delegation but was the brains behind it, they disagreed on a heck of a lot. But they were both significantly against free capital flows. In fact, White more so, more against it than Keynes. So nobody had seriously considered at Bretton Woods an open capital account. So the system we have now is very, very different from the one that was designed.
Right, but that the system that you're talking about of ever-growing private capital flows, that started to evolve in the late 60s, and maybe even a little earlier. But by the time, by the period I'm writing about, they were massive. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's, in a sense, the most powerful driving force in the whole story is not about a person or an idea. It's really the market, which allowed for these flows to move very, very fast and to, you know, move to take advantage of different anomalies. And so in the end, there was no policy that could contain that. And when they, especially when the oil price changed and there was a massive need for recycling from the OPEC countries back to the developed and the developing world, no fixed system could have handled that. Yeah. There would have been no way. So I'm totally agreeing with you that we had to get here one way or another. And kind of looking back, I think it was done in the best way that it could. I mean, this was not some academic exercise.
Kathy Mann.
Hi there, Catherine Mann. I'm sort of the teen jobs right now, global chief economist at Citi, outgoing and incoming external member of the Monetary Policy Committee of the Bank of England. Fascinating discussion here. I think it is so important for us to have our historical perspective on many topics, of course, but certainly these topics that are so germane today. It's also, of course, extremely interesting to understand the personalities and how that, you know, how that plays a very important role in the outcome. But the question, of course, is what are those lessons going to help us understand about prospects going forward? And so listening to a couple of the comments that you both made in your remarks and also in answering Ted and so forth is, you know, The facts on the ground right now, I suppose, are one, no one is happy with the current dollar-based, dollar-dominant financial system, okay? Second, you were commenting that nobody can, you can see the crisis coming, but you don't want to take action because it might precipitate the crisis, and who wants to do that? Number three, is this the best that we're going to get? There's no better alternative than the system that we have right now because of the dominance of domestic objectives, and that exchange rates are still secondary for those domestic objectives. And I guess the last point and the question really is, keying off your comments just right now on the capital flows, is if there's going to be a crisis, it will be precipitated by financial flows. And how are they going to do it this time, if that's the direction, if the crisis that gets precipitated happens through the channel of global financial flows? So what do our lessons teach us?
That's a really great question, and I would be lying if I told you I could answer it, but I'd like to just point to a few things. And may just make the analogy between the events I wrote about and today. You know, when the US made the decision to delink the dollar from gold, there, under Paul Volcker's guidance and his predecessor, his predecessor as undersecretary of treasury, there had been really massive, and they worked very closely with the Fed. They had done a massive amount of analysis about all the options that they had. And they did it in a very highly professional way, in great secrecy, really, because if any of that had gotten out, there would have been unbelievable financial turbulence. So my first point is that I hope somewhere there is to use a term in the military, the plans don't matter so much, but the planning does, and. I think they took the only measures they could, but it wasn't like it was just pulled out of the dark. So that, that's one thing I think would be very important. But there's a big difference between then and now, and that is the U.S. has nowhere near the unilateral leverage today that it had in 1971. And so this kind of planning and anticipation and contingency planning, it's going to have to be done with more than just, internal to the United States. Another thing that comes to my mind thinking about the 71 experience is it never ends up where you think. You can't control the global capital markets. So that thinking about what happens next has to encompass a whole range of possibilities that you might not think is going to happen, but will, because of some forces that, just basically exceed the human capacity to fully understand and anticipate. So what you're talking about is, I think, absolutely essential. I think there are a lot of similarities if you think about a crisis scenarios. I mean, then inflation was a big deal. Now we're there's very, very possible that we're gonna head in that direction. Then the deficits were growing, and today we have exactly the same situation. Then there was a very serious bout of nationalism, and I don't have to comment on that today. They had a big advantage that we don't have. They had it, although Nixon had a Democratic Congress, both houses were Democratic majority. The amount of coordination between the moderate Democrats and the moderate Republicans in Nixon's time was very substantial. And in fact, everything Nixon, what the decision Nixon and Connally made were wildly supported by the Congress. In fact, after the decisions were made, there must have been 12 sets of hearings exploring the new world that was about to be launched. And I think about those hearings, and I studied all those hearings. Inconceivable that we would have something like that today. Inconceivable, because those hearings were really thoughtful. And they examined all the questions, including what if exchange rates don't work? So there was a lot of intellectual, that's the wrong word. There was a lot of really thoughtful policy ferment, which I mean, I'm not so close to it now, but I don't think it exists today. And so the question you're posing about the next crisis, I think this is a real problem.
You know, Jeff, I noticed the same thing studying the early Truman period when I was writing on the Marshall Plan, and now I'm writing a political biography of Henry Wallace. Truman was faced with a Republican Congress from 46 to 48. But despite the fact that he called it the do-nothing Congress, an enormous amount was actually accomplished, particularly when it came to foreign economic affairs, things like creation of the Marshall Plan, which couldn't have happened without bipartisan support. And there was a lot of ferocious debate, but it was meaningful debate. There were many sophisticated hearings, just like you're describing now. And Republican Senator Arthur Vandenberg, who was chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, stood up and he said, you know, any prominent person out there who's standing up and screaming that we're doing everything wrong, I'm going to subpoena him or her. And they're going to have to come before us and make their case to the American people. We want to hear what their better ideas are. It was sort of a democracy at its most robust. So there are examples in history, not just the one that you described, where we did do remarkable things with divided government. I wanted to ask you a question about the IMF. When the IMF was created at Bretton Woods, it was really envisioned that it would be an institution that would, you know, just grease the gears of the international monetary system. It was certainly never envisioned by either the Americans or the British as an international crisis firefighter. If countries got into some balance of payments difficulties, they could borrow on concessionary terms briefly, but if that weren't enough, then they had to go off and make significant structural changes on their own. But that was not the IMF's job. Fast forward to the 1970s and everything changes. Now the IMF is putting out one major forest fire after another in the era of floating exchange rates. Of course, the whole foundation of the international monetary system changes. The IMF was built to preside over a system that was founded on gold, right? And in 1970s, it actually becomes prohibited to link your currency to gold. You can link it to Bitcoin or whatever you want, but not gold. Can you talk us through how the IMF changed after these 3 days in August 1971?
Well, you know, there's one, it's kind of one interesting scene in the book where Conley invites Paul Schweitzer, mm-hmm. who's head of the IMF, to watch Nixon give his speech delinking the dollar from gold. And Schweitzer knows nothing about this. He didn't know what Nixon was going to say. And he listened.
Which was a violation of our own commitment.
Right. I mean, that day we sent a letter to the IMF telling them what we're going to do. But took Schweitzer by total surprise. And he was fit to be tied. And when the speech was over, Conley was going to talk to him, but Conley got called out of the meeting. So Conley, Volcker, and a guy named John Petty, who many of you may know, a distinguished international banker, Petty was the assistant secretary of the Treasury. Three of them were there with Schweitzer. Conley gets called out, Volcker gets called out, and Petty is just mortified by the way Schweitzer's been treated, because Schweitzer, this whole thing came as a surprise. And Petty asked Schweitzer if he wants a briefing, and he said, no thanks, and he just leaves. And I tell this story because the US had a very uneasy relationship with the IMF, as far as I could tell. It was, you know, when you think about the post-war global financial system, it really was the US that was running that and pushing the IMF around. And even into the 70s, it was, the IMF took up a bigger role because, in fact, the financial, there were many more countries that were caught up with financial problems, starting with the era of OPEC. All these developing countries needed help because they didn't have oil, or they were importing very expensive oil. And even the British and the Italians needed IMF help. So the US really could, you know, the Marshall Plan era was over. In fact, Peterson argued in the August meetings that we've got to get beyond this Marshall Plan mentality. We the Americans can't run everything anymore. We can't shoulder all those burdens. And so I think the IMF became a very important instrument to internationalize the international effort. And so if you look at the 70s and the 80s, to the 90s, the IMF really, I think, became much more central. And as you said, I don't think Henry Dexter White would have ever envisioned this institution growing in the way it did.
Well, one more question before we close, Jeff. As you know, there are a lot of prominent commentators, including very respected academics, people like Joe Stiglitz, who think that the dollar-dominated international monetary system is not to our advantage. The fact that the world uses the US dollar as its primary reserve currency, trade vehicle, et cetera, actually does damage to our economy, for example, by keeping the dollar at a higher exchange value than it otherwise would be at. On the other side, the type of financial sanctions that we're constantly imposing against countries like North Korea, Iran, Russia would be impossible without this sort of dominance, without the fact that countries find it very difficult to escape the dollar-based system. How do you see this debate?
Well, I think that the dollar, on balance, I think we're very lucky that we have the dollar, and the dollar is really dominant. And I say that because it allows us, since everybody is willing to hold dollars, we can finance our needs in a way no other country can. And we can do it at lower rates. And I just don't know how this unwieldy, consumer-oriented, undisciplined country that we have would exist if we had a normal currency and we were subject to the normal discipline of the markets. I mean, in some theoretical sense, maybe you could say that is good, but I don't know how you would get from here to there if your goal was to make the dollar one of a handful of currencies and create, let's say, you know, a multipolar global financial system. So I understand where Stiglitz is coming from, but I think in the real world it's not going to happen it's not going to happen deliberately. If it happens, I'll tell you how I think it will. I think that, you know, I'm a guy who doesn't know how to who's still learning how to do email, so I'm not the one to talk about the digital age. But I know this, that we are at the very, very beginnings of a digital world, and I think that the nature of currencies and the challenge to the dollar is going to come in some form of digital innovation, and that the risk will be that we won't be fast enough to actually adapt to it, or that we will think that the dollar somehow bestows on us certain rights forever. But that's not for tomorrow. That's not for the, you know, that's a couple of decades away, I think. But I can't imagine a meeting like the one I wrote about, in which there's a decision to try to eclipse the kind of clout that the dollar has.
Jeff, we're at the end of our time, so I want to congratulate you again on an important and fascinating new book. And I want to thank you in particular for a very stimulating discussion in front of our council members here today. Thank you very much, Jeff.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.